What's On Guide to live stream events and shows is now available. You can find the guide on the web at independencelive.net, on multiple Facebook pages, or go direct with the web link tvl.ink/whatsonguide.
Fiona from Pac-Man and Show Women for Independence. Did you know we have a podcast on Indie Live Radio? Goes out at 10 o'clock on a Tuesday morning, repeated at 6 o'clock on a Thursday. Come and join us for some news, views, opinions, the odd poem. Be very nice to have you with us. And come and hear the news you're not getting. Hear some new voices for a new Scotland at Indie Live Radio.
Hello, my name's Steve B and I'm a presenter on Indie Live Radio. I present Music and Musings every Friday night at 7. The music? That's 70s classic rock, although we will take the occasional side road. The musings? Well, they're thoughts on Scottish independence, politics and world events from my viewpoint, which is that of a grumpy old man. So join me every Friday night at 7 on Indie Live Radio, a new voice for a new Scotland. What's On Guide to live stream events and shows is now available. You can find the guide on the web at independencelive.net, on multiple Facebook pages, or go direct with the web link tvl.ink/whatsonguide.
You'll be part of it. It's Independence Live. Yeah, a few people asked about YouTube. It'll be YouTube/Independence Live. That's where you'll find the footage.
No Westminster. No Westminster, come on. No Westminster, not for me, not for me. But before I'll be your slave, I'll be buried in my grave and go home to my Lord and be free. Oh, freedom, come on.
hands-on guide to live stream events and shows is now available. You can find the guide on the web at independencelive.net, on multiple Facebook pages, or go direct with the web link tvl.ink/whatsonguide.
Hello everyone, John Drummond here, your host of the TNT show every Wednesday live at 7 p.m. And this is all to tell you about our great guest who's coming up this Wednesday. Eddie Reader is joining us. You don't want to miss this. Know all about her singing career, her background, her extraordinary Irish ancestry, and her love for Scotland. Don't miss it, 7 p.m. Wednesday. The Nation talks to Eddie Reader.
Hi there, I'm Cliff.
And I'm Russ.
And we're from the Veterans for Scottish Independence 2.0 group. And we're just invading your privacy today to let you know that we will be very shortly pushing a program out on live stream to do with the veterans, their needs, as it will be during an independent campaign, the next independence campaign, and indeed in an independent Scotland.
So get yourself in gear, come and join us, pull up a sandbag.
Yes.
Thank you.
Cheers.
Wherever you stand, get the fresh view of what's happening in Scotland with iScot. Celebrate everything about our country with intelligent, in-depth insight from lifestyle, culture to puzzles. And all the opinions you'll need, whether it's digital or by post, subscribe now to iScot.
Building the Scottish state with myself. This week, I'm very pleased to be joined by Pete Wishart, MP from Perthshire. And so, first of all, thank you for joining us.
I'm delighted, and thank you very much for having me. And I could see you enjoying yourself very much in Wren, and I could sense that the weather's rather nicer than what we're having across here in the UK.
It is actually gorgeous.
Enjoy, yes. Yeah. Really pleasure to be here.
Absolutely. I first wanted to just begin to explain the digital covenant that we have been developing over the past year or so, and also in addition to the wiki.scottishconstitution.com site that I've been developing as well with these other coders. And so the digital covenant is a blockchain-based covenant, meaning that every time when you sign, you have a transaction code that is like, I don't know, 25 letters or numbers long. So it's completely unique. And because of the degree of encryption you have to spend cryptocurrency on it, but we've been able to get the price of the transactions very, very low, like a fraction of a cent per transaction. So so you can see the really hard work the coders have put into it. And so once you're registered, to sign it, you download proof of address and an identity card, and then it's rigorously verified. We do have a capacity for people like myself to sign and to support, but it doesn't count towards it. It has to be people living in Scotland who sign. So it's, again, each of the signatures is rigorously verified. Once they get the transaction takes place, they have a code which is completely unhackable and immutable. So it's a way of, so what we see is a future for blockchain democracy begins with the people signing it and getting their own block, to which pretty much anything can be, put in, because it's like it's also called distributed ledger technology. Like you have a big ledger, and where you write stuff down, obviously digitally, but it just simply cannot be hacked. It's because of the extremely high levels of encryption. It can't be hacked. So, for example, if assuming we were able to get these signatures, and even if independence is by a different route, it doesn't really matter as long as it's achieved somehow. We would also have the transaction IDs for everyone, and then that would enable. It's limitless, really. I mean, everybody could have their own state bank account. You could have self-sovereign identity cards. They could serve for practically everything. I mean, it could distribute benefits that way. Right now, you could just put currency into people's hands, via their card, and they wouldn't have, and you could give them, guaranteed minimum income. I mean, the possibilities are absolutely limitless. So the idea is that it was kind of a backstop, failing, because we just don't know how it's going with the referendum, Section 30, all of that. It would be, hopefully within the coming months, it would be a means to irrefutably demonstrate support for independence. How the mechanisms are after that is, we just don't know, with regard to a referendum. But at the very least, it would reinforce the democratic legitimacy of any vote, and at most, it could in our view, it could serve as a means if the Scottish government was to affirm that yes, if we get this number of signatures, that we would declare independence. But you hold that it's not that simple.
Yes, if only it was, and all we needed to do was to get 2.2 million signatures and declare independence. I'd love that to be the case, but there's a number of problems and issues which we'll maybe touch on as part of our conversation. But just first of all, I think it's a great initiative and well done to everybody involved in the Digital Covenant. I'm not all that familiar with some of the concepts around this, but I had a look at it today and I just think it's great.
The FAQs are very explanatory.
I did see that, and very helpful and a beautifully designed page. And it's certainly something I found very, very interesting. And anything that helps to build capacity for Scottish independence, particularly in the sort of next year, 18 months we're going to have, is going to be so important and critical. So well done, and I understand all the marches that are going on too, which will help to just bring an attention and focus on the cost of independence that's desperately required as we're going to go forward into the next year. And and again, some of the work you're doing on the digital is just great. I mean, we live in almost a stone age democracy where you still turn up to churches and village halls to vote with bits of paper and pencils. And so anything that moves that on and involves conversations and discussions.
Even if somehow it is done with a pen and, a paper ballot, which it just seems absurd at this point, the infrastructure that we're building can easily be
totally
adapted into.
And I think the time for that is coming. And I think that, like all the other innovations that you discussed and the features that could be built in are immensely useful and helpful as we go forward and improving our democracy and ensuring that we remain as open, transparent, and communicative with the public. So I very much welcome all that. And also, like going back to the 1950s with John McCormick, with the original Scottish Covenant as it was, and the 2 million signatures that they secured. I think what that did was redefine some of the debate around home rule as it was then, but the journey for Home Rule was the kickoff and start and the move towards independence. Mm-hmm. And without that, like being a feature in the evolving story about Scotland's journey in terms of devolution and independence, you know, like we wouldn't be where we are today. We've got sustained majority support for independence with an all-time high, 55% or 56% if we believe in the secret poll from Whitehall.
The support is there. It's just, I'm playing devil's advocate to a certain extent, but I mean, why not? Why not just say, why not?
There's a number of reasons why not, and one of them is the very obvious one. The UK government would just say no, and that doesn't really help us. If they're going to say no to a mandate which has a referendum at the heart of it, they're not going to say yes to a petition being delivered to them that creates the basis, the grounds for a nation to become independent. And I just actually believe that if we're going to do this, we're going to do this right. We've got to make sure that if we're going to become an independent nation, that everything that we do along that journey is absolutely the right thing to do in terms of like securing that international recognitions at the end of this process, and that we're totally engaged with the Scottish people and we're taking them with them. And I just don't believe that we can have independence in a nation without the majority of the Scottish people expressing that democratically by means of a dedicated referendum. It's just how it'll have to be done in a modern democracy. And I think that's where we have to go in securing this. Now, we're now at record levels of support for independence. And I always believed that when I wrote my route map to independence, and I said in that the hardest part of that route map was stage one, getting to majority support. That's the hardest bit, believe it. Of all the things we have to do to get to a position where over 50% of our fellow Scots believe that independence is their future, that was always going to be the bit that was going to involve the hardest part. Because think of what we're ranged against, the whole apparatus of the UK state. Decades and centuries of cultural and national assumptions about Scotland's place within the United Kingdom haven't they been taken head on through debate, through argument? We've done that. We've done that. Everything else subsequently is going to be easier. Now, we talk about Section 30 and all the various things that Westminster has apparently has this gift in saying no. And they might, I don't know what Boris Johnson will do next May, if we get, you know, another independence majority, and if that independence majority is based on a majority for the Scottish National Party, and we replicate the conditions of 2011. You know, so all the democratic arguments are taken away. I don't know if Boris Johnson will say no at that point. I suspect that he probably won't, because it's a difficult position for the Conservatives to be in. I'll tell you why, just and then you can come back on this. Sure. Because it stops being about a referendum. If we've got majority support based on the majority of the Scottish people, it has nothing to do with a referendum anymore. He has to take on democracy itself. And that is a very, very uncomfortable place for any government in democracy. So, like, the choice that they will have, and this is the thing that I think will make up their minds for them, is whether they just say, okay, right, you know, fair enough, Gov, you've got a majority, accept it, same conditions as 2011, let's just do it and get out of the way. There's still a chance of winning this, or they dig in. Whatever they do, we win. If they dig in, they will have to be overcome, and they'll have to be brought to, because you cannot deny a majority in a democracy. So there's certain things I suggested in my route map about what we do in that situation, in position. But I don't think, the more they say no, the bigger our support grows. And it would just make sense for them to do it at a point where there's still a chance that they would win it, because they won't win it further down the line. And at some point, they're going to get beat, and at some point, they'll have to do this. And I just think when they're sitting around the table considering all of this, that they're just going to say, it's not worth it. It's not worth it. UK has more experience to deal with independence movements than any other nation in the world.
I mean, which one of them has to come back in? Big fat zero, you know?
None of them. Absolutely none of them. And all of them won because we're a majority against the UK. You know, so like,
well, America was.
They know about all of this. And, you know, we're not going to get into some of the issues that other nations have, and they've secured their independence. And because we're a modern democracy, it'll be done democratically. That's how it has to be done. And it's just the way it is when we live
in. Again, playing devil's advocate, this is a way of democratically affirming.
No, it's not. You know, there's no debate, there's no proposition, there's nothing which has been done which engages people into national conversations about independence. All it really is asking people to sign a petition. So you're not, you're, you're, And it just wouldn't be, I mean, you could go to the international community and say, listen, we're going to be independent because 2.2 million people around Scotland signed a petition. They would laugh at you. Seriously, none of them would ever for a minute countenance that as a means to secure independence. I mean, you know, like if Catalonia did what they did, because after a referendum, after declared their independence and it was rejected, I just don't, great though it is, and it's fantastic to help build the capacity, but like, I know people are desperate for the shortcuts. I know they want independence to happen yesterday. And people are grabbing at any means possible to try and see if there's a way to circumvent what we really need to do. But this is hard work. We're trying to get our independence, our freedom as a nation. And nobody said this was ever going to be easy. Now, if there was a shortcut, if there was a way that could get us seamlessly to independence without having to do that hard crap, I would grab it in a minute and I would embrace it wholly, but I've just not seen any yet.
I do want to make this point about the international recognition, because the UN and others are, first of all, they don't, it's not illegal to make a universal declaration of independence, and the UK was part of that case. But the international law is quite agnostic, really, about how it's achieved. But if it is done democratically, nonviolently, which obviously it is, and it states the true desire for self-determination, which this would, I have no doubt that quite a few countries might recognize.
I think we'll just have to sort of differ in terms of our interpretation of what other nations would do with respect to that. And I just don't believe that, you know, that would achieve the result that you want. And, you know, I mean, we've seen several examples that where that is the case. And, you know, I mean, we just have to knuckle down here. I mean, it's only 6 years since our last independence referendum. I can't believe we're back to this situation and position. And we're at the stage now that we're probably going to secure an SNP majority at the next Holyrood election. And we're probably going to do that on the back of a majority of the Scottish people. We will have a powerful democratic case at that point in order to ensure that we get our independence referendum. And if the UK government dig in, there's means that we could get around that to ensure. I mean, there's only two ways to get independence. And I think we have to acknowledge this and accept it. One is through working with what's internationally called the parent state, an inelegant term, and one that obviously
the parent state.
The UK is, in terms of when it comes to international law, the parent state. So we have to get their agreement, arrangement, and cooperation, ensuring of independence. And you know that's what we did in 2014 when we had the Edinburgh Agreement, which led to both sides participating in the democratic contest about the future of our country. So you do that with cooperation and partnership with what we refer to as the parent state, or you do it through a universal declaration of independence. There's only two ways to do it. And like where your petition would likely take us in terms of just declaring independence is the UDI route. Now, the UDI route is fraught with huge difficulties, problems, and things that will always be almost impossible to surmount. For first of all, would we take Scottish people with us and something like that? That's a big question.
But this petition specifically, cancels the dissolves the Treaty of Union. Okay, which is what Scottish, you know, Scottish being part of the UK is based on. They broke. I mean, today more than ever, the UK has broken the Treaty of Union in clear violation of leaving Scots law alone. I mean, that's basis for. I mean, that's a basis for pulling out of the treaty, just as the UK decided to get out of Brexit. Which
I think you're getting the attacks on our democracy a little bit confused with different things that are going on. Tomorrow, what we're going to have is the internal market bill, which is all the issues that are today about the Northern Irish Protocol and the very curious admissions from the UK government that they're prepared to overturn international law in order to ensure this. The other thing that you're referring to is the plans from the Department of Justice to end judicial review, not just in England and Wales, but in Scotland. That's where Treaty of Union quite clearly will be broken. So there's two different and distinct things going on. We'll see tomorrow for the first time what this internal markets bill will look like. And, you know, we now know, because the government admitted it, that this tears up entirely articles within the withdrawal agreement as related to Northern Ireland. And we know also, because, you know, like we, we've been informed in advance what this means to Scottish democracy, to the powers of Parliament, and what we consider to be the power grab and the subsumation of the Scottish Parliament into a general UK environment when it comes to trading across the United Kingdom. Huge implications and repercussions for our democracy in Scotland, for the very nature and essence of devolution, and something that will be challenged and fought very, very hard by Scottish Government colleagues and by my colleagues in Westminster.
Yeah, and what do you see that involving? I mean, from what you do know about it, and from the nature of the UK government, especially the Tory UK government, I mean, is there going to be a Scottish Parliament in a few weeks or a few months? I mean, are their powers going to be taken over? Or are they going to be neutered? I mean,
I think it's almost certain that the UK government will get their internal markets both through because they've got a massive majority in Westminster, and you know, like we'll put up the political argument about why this is wrong and why this impacts Scottish democracy the way it does. We have to accept that the UK government, you know, has a majority in Parliament, and like what I observe from the Conservative backbenches, there's never been a sense of any sort of rebellion, and they're certainly not going to rebel over issues to do with the Scottish Parliament. So I think we have to accept that this will get through. But what that does is then build the political case. If this is something the UK government is prepared to do, that just adds more people to support what we're doing. And also, when it comes to this, it's, you know, I mean, the Scottish government could hold up in terms of legislative consent and the Seoul Convention to ensure that that won't get passed. So, you know, you do end up in a place where you can pretty much, you know, like, put forward all your objections and see what you could do to ensure this could be defeated. But, you know, I mean, look at this. This is why we're out of the union. We don't want to be run by conservative majorities that we didn't vote for.
That's all the more reason to adopt the covenant as the means to. I mean, maybe it isn't that simple, but I think you need to get out now, and this is a means to do so. I mean,
I had a meeting yesterday with a guy called Lord Dunlop, who probably most of you
know. I know.
We'll probably know very little about. Now, Andrew Dunlop's been tasked by the UK government to, it's called, what's called strengthening the union. And I was involved in a meeting as chair of the Scottish Affairs Committee with colleagues from the Welsh Affairs Committee, Northern Irish, because he wanted to tell us in advance like what this actually meant and what it was going to do. And there's two things that came out of that. Like, and one thing that I picked up almost immediately is these guys haven't got a clue. I mean, the crisis in unionism is just overwhelming. I mean, they have no idea about how to take us on anymore, and they're desperately grasping at anything in order to try and build the case for the union, which is totally threadbare. And yesterday I was totally knocked out and surprised just how threadbare that is. So a couple of things that they're going to do, and one is to try and like Scotland-proof the whole of Whitehall. So anything that happens in terms of developments, whatever, will be Scotland-proofed, and nothing will be done unless it's strengthening the union. And the second is the thing that I find really funny, is that they actually think this is going to help them. It's what I call slap a jack in it, which is they're going to rebrand all the stuff from the Prosperity Fund as, you know, like paid for by the largesse of the UK government. And they somehow think that through their visibility, we're going to learn to love them, which is just one of the most bonkers sort of contentions to make. But this is all they've got. And this is
the that's what is a little bit disconcerting, because you're speaking about building support for independence and, you know, and the desperate things they're doing to abide by with regard to public opinion, but I don't think they care about public opinion. I mean, I really don't. I think they'll just go ahead and mow on, neuter the Scottish government. They don't care.
In my roadmap, this is where we get into the what we do next then. You know, like if they do dig in, right, just, I'm not sure they will, okay? And like I really believe that when they're assessing where they are, what's likely to happen, and what the eventual outcome is Scotland being an independent country. I mean, I don't think there's anybody in Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom who doesn't believe that anymore. I mean, the Conservatives are preparing for this. Conservatives are preparing for an independence referendum. I can tell you that right now. Mm-hmm. And I know that might come as a surprise to some of the people, but they are now looking at this. And if you listen to any Conservatives now, you can sense that, you can feel that coming. So Scotland will be, so it doesn't matter what they do. What will happen is that we will become an independent country. But just say they do, say no, right? And they say no, 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 all the way down the line. We're not going to participate in a legally binding referendum. We're not going to give you the mechanism and the process that we agreed to last time round. Then we start to do things. And like I suggested a couple of things that we could do as a start. And one is to start to withdraw from the apparatus of the UK state. Things like the Joint Ministerial Committee, the infrastructure that deals with the management of four nations across the UK, we could start to come out of that. We could look at our involvement and participation other in the features of the Union of the United Kingdom. And then we start to behave like an independent nation. So things around the reserve powers, particularly in foreign affairs, we start to build a bigger profile for ourselves. We do things, and we challenge the UK government. If you don't like it, then take us to court, do what you can. You know, like, we'll see you there. And then we deal. What is the important thing at the end of this is international recognition, particularly through the EU. The EU is critical to all of this.
Oh, I agree with that. And I want to interject. I think, you know, whether it be the covenant or whatever, I don't think you would need much to get international recognition from the EU. I mean, considering the way that the British government has been acting, I mean, especially today when they openly said, yeah, it's a violation. I mean, the UK is not, it can't even be trusted to based on the agreements. And I think if Scotland said, look, we got this covenant, you know, it affirms a majority support for independence, I think a lot of them would accept it. I think, for example, in, what was it, 1989 or 91, I forget, when they just accepted, Eastern Europe into, a former communist dictatorship all of a sudden becomes part of the EU. I think they'd be quite accommodating. I honestly do. I mean,
then you've got the example of Catalonia where there wasn't, you know, and this is the issue.
I know, and I followed that very, very, very closely.
And that's a difficulty we get. That's more the precedent when it comes to a substate of the UK is no longer in the EU, but a substate of a European nation. And this is the territory we've got to avoid. We've got to make sure we don't end up like that. What the Catalonians didn't do, and I remember several of us going over, and I remember speaking to Carles Puigdemont like in advance of the Catalan referendum and their campaign then, was the whole thing was getting that recognition. And the Catalans didn't make much of an attempt to have conversations and discussions in advance of what they were doing. We can't make that mistake. I was getting to the point that if nothing happens with the UK, we've done all these things, we've tried everything possible to engage them, then we're going to have a Scottish-designed referendum. We're going to have to do that. And that's when we need that international support at the end of all this. And that's when we need to start to be able to have these conversations with international partners, particularly around the EU. Now, a lot of us spend a lot of time in Brussels speaking to people, and you're absolutely right. There's a warming up to this idea of Scotland being an independent nation. They're not there yet. They're a long, long way from this. And they're bound by being a treaty-based organisation about how they can do things and how they can assist and support. So there's a whole host of hurdles still to be crossed when it comes to that proper and right type of engagement. But we've got to do that because we cannot end up in a situation where whatever we do won't be internationally recognised. The UK government will do what you want. You're still part of the UK, regardless of what you think about yourselves. You're in the situation that Catalonia are in, you know, where they did effectively declare UDI and found themselves in this weird situation just now where they're not any further closer to being independent, and at the same time options for them have been severely curtailed.
I've spent a lot of time there over the past few years, and I know the situation very well, but one of the main differences is that Scotland is by definition a separate nation, whereas under the Spanish constitution it's not. You know,
totally.
A lot of the repression was based on the indissoluble nation. I see, just for our viewers, I see the questions coming in. We'll talk for a few more minutes and then we'll get to the questions. But the Spanish state is really, really repressive. And they got people in jail for 12 years for organizing a referendum. It was not illegal, but it was the judge. There's no law against holding a referendum. It was simply that the judges were persecuting them and saying, no, don't do that, do that. Oh, you did it. Okay, you're going to get charged with that. And there's no trial. There wasn't a trial by jury. It was charging them with things like I helped translate the 500-page case that for the political prisoners. And I mean, things like, you know, spending money on flyers and pamphlets was in there. Like, these are big crimes. I mean, and you know, the UK is a very, very different entity. Yep. And I see what you mean about international recognition, but I think I really feel that after
who have you spoken to about this? I mean, what gives you any comfort? I mean, you've got your 2.2 million signatures. Who have you gone to and said, well, listen, like, I believe this is a basis for Scotland being an independent nation. Who said to you that, yeah, that's all right, fair enough, you've got a petition.
Yeah.
Who said that to you?
Well, I mean, it's legal. Well, it's legal under international law. I haven't spoken to any leader saying, would you recognize this? But as I said, international law is agnostic on it. And as long as independence is achieved democratically, affirming a desire for self-determination among a majority, then it's legal. There's no means it's illegal. I mean, Catalonia, that was a, you know, under the Spanish state, an illegal referendum, and they came down like a ton of bricks on Puigdemont and others. This is different. You know, it's a different way of affirming majority support for independence, which again is, there's nothing illegal about it. I mean, anybody can sign a petition, but as you correctly point out, the question is, how do you get it recognized? And that's what we could start working on.
That's exactly the work that we're going to have. It's going to be a massive shift. There's going to be lots and lots of hard work and lots of conversations to get that international.
I don't know. I mean, again, your point where, you know, your point where, oh, well, you know, after all this but it'll become unsustainable for the UK government. I just don't think I just think they're impervious to public opinion. I mean, that's just my view. You know, I mean, you would know better than I do. I think I observe them
closely, and we have to observe them. We have to make sure that we know what they're doing and we're looking at. And yesterday's conversation with Andrew Dunlop was fascinating, just to see exactly.
Tell me a bit about it.
Where they are, and there was a thing about the slap a jack in it and the Whitehall proofing of
slap a jack on it. Right. Yeah.
So basically, the case is, they don't know what they're going to do this time, right? And the premise, I think, of all the thing that the union case did last time was totally blown out the water with Brexit. That's the rules and the terms of engagement for constitutional issues, the way that Brexit was conducted, debated, and the aftermath of all that. So all this stuff and the premise that underpinned the union case is sort of gone with all of that. But they're in real trouble, and even some of the most hardened unionists are starting to accept that, you know, like this looks likely, this looks like the referendum come, but they might not. You're right, and I think what we've got to do is to plan for that happening. Hopefully, it will. You know, like, and we've recreated the conditions 2011 when it's last time it was agreed. You know, like, and they might just think, well, you know, we're best going now. What's the point of waiting when things get worse for us down the line? We've got a chance of winning it, you know, like next year, but like 2 years, but saying no to the Scottish people, not just saying no to the Scottish people, but saying no to Scottish democracy, that puts them in a very, very invidious situation. You might continue to say no, they might be impervious totally to democratic debate. That's when you start to do the other things, which will bring them to the table. And if they're still saying no, that is when you have the Scottish design referendum. That's what we have to do on our own. Mm-hmm. At that point, when we've done everything possible to engage them, we've started to take our position out of some of the institutions of the UK state, we've started to act and behave like an independent nation anyway, we've done all of that, and they're still saying no, no, no. Support for independence is at 70%, they're saying no. Then at that point, we would have to have our own independence referendum. It would have to be one designed in Scotland. Now, that will probably be illegal. And I've followed the Martin Keating's case. I've seen some of the legal opinions about all this. And Martin Keating's would probably have lost, because if you look very carefully at the Scotland Act 1998, if you look at legal opinion shaping up and determining that, you can't do anything other than to come to a conclusion that would either be declared illegal or at least not be able to make a decision based on all this. The chances of success were very, very limited. So we do that, but we have to then build the capacity internationally to ensure that this is going to be supported. And the key thing about a Scottish design referendum, we're going to have to get 50% of the nation to vote yes for it to have any credibility. So it's tough. This is why I'm saying it's hard work.
We've already got like 50%.
Signing a petition. This is hard, hard nation building work that we're going to have to get involved in. And if they continue to say no, that it gets harder. And that's when we have to dig in and find the resources. There'll be lots of patients that's going to be involved. There'll be fallouts. There'll be all sorts of things happening. But we will be committed to delivering this. Mm-hmm. And whatever it takes to do it, we will have to do it, because the Scottish people will have said to us, and we'll have an obligation to them to deliver this. Mm-hmm. So hopefully it'll be done quickly. Hopefully the UK government will see sense and believe that there's no point in digging in for an entrenched fight. But that's their choice. That'll be up to them. We'll continue to push for independence. We'll do it in partnership with them. We'll do it to force them into partnership, or we'll do it without them. Mm-hmm. So that's what we have to do. And we have to do it in steps, sometimes small steps, sometimes big steps. We've crossed the first step, and that was getting majority support.
Right.
That was the key one and the hardest one to get over. We've done that now. Mm. The rest of them are subsequently easier as we go forward. The next fight, the next step to cross will be to secure the means and the process of being able to demonstrate our independence, whether that's through a referendum, they agree with the UK government, whether it's one that we'll have to design on our own. That will be the next stage.
I do understand that I just read an article yesterday that says that the Scottish government before, quote unquote, before the end of this session, a parliamentary session, will set a date for a referendum.
I think what that does is everybody goes on about the mandates, right? Why don't you use the mandate? You've got 5, 6, a collection of mandates. The UK government couldn't give a fig about these mandates, because what they see with these mandates, this is their view, is that they're conditional and an afterthought. You know, like they're stuck away in a manifesto, or they say we will have our independence if we get this, if we get that. Next time around, and what this referendum bill is going to do, the draft bill is going to do, is going to come before Parliament. But there's no ambiguity about it. It will be, we will have a referendum. That'll be it. No conditions. No caveats. And if the majority of people support that, that's what will happen. And there will be a date given to all this, and we'll be going ahead, and we'll have this. Now, in partnership with the UK, perfect. No problem. That's where we easily transition into independence without any legal challenge, without any constitutional questions, without any sort of afterthought about international recognitions. But it might not be with that. And that's where it gets hard. That's where it gets tough work. You know, like there's going to be a lot of stuff that we're going to have to do in order to get there. And I wish it was just as easy as signing a petition. It's not. Sorry, Mark.
I think it could be, but I'm just planting the seed. You know, I'm just planting the seed. But think about it. But I just think there's a real urgency with Brexit, with because when the UK leaves the EU, they will have no constraints whatsoever. They were bound by the EU treaties. They couldn't do this. They couldn't do that. Now, I mean, you've got the American multinationals rushing in. The Scotland risks losing their brands. They're already plotting. I mean, they got Tony Abbott for trade commissioner from Australia to come in here and do it. I just think there's a real urgency to
be offering. What do you think is going to happen? The UK is leaving the European Union. We're probably going to be leaving now without any deal. It's going to be chaos and crisis.
No, food shortages, medicine shortages. Flights can't fly.
there's nothing. Nothing good about what's coming our way. But that doesn't
all the more reason to embrace the covenant and get out in the next months, in my view. I mean, these are exigent circumstances.
This is the question that how? You know, there's a process that we do this. And the other thing, one thing I'm keen to do just now, and again, I wrote it in my roadmap, and maybe certainly could hear that later on, is when we talk about the independence movement, we forget that it's a huge span and range of opinions about independence. Sure. Now, Perth, where I'm from, right, is probably now a yes city. We voted overwhelmingly to stay within the union. What changed that was people coming to us through the Brexit process, people who voted to remain at the Brexit vote but still voted no to Scottish independence. Now, their new recruits and their tenure supporters, they're nervous and they're anxious about this. They're giving us the benefit of the doubt just now, but people could easily be switched back. Mm-hmm. What we've got to do in terms of a movement is to make sure that these people, your new, anxious, tenuous supporters of independence, are united with the just get it doneers. you know, the people who want independence yesterday. And we've got to design a way forward that takes everybody with us, which reassures the tentative new recruit that somehow satisfies the just get it doneers who just want to be there already.
Okay. And I don't want to interrupt you, but we've just got a few minutes left and I wanted to get to some of the questions before we go. From Lorraine Sinclair, this crucial time for independence, how can you get yes groups, keep the independence movement going? I'll do a couple groups. The internal market bill goes through. What will Westminster SNP MPs do to mark this power grab, e.g. a walkout? From Indy Law, the Westminster regime is capable of reneging on the withdrawal agreement. What are the chances they will attempt to shut down Holyrood on the 1st of July 2021?
All these are huge questions, and you know, I mean, the one thing about where we're going is totally uncharted territory. We don't really know how they will behave and how they'll respond. We know that it's going to be ugly, it's going to be nasty. There will be, as we've seen already, the assaults on Scottish Parliament, Scottish democracy. But this doesn't work for them, and they know it. And some of the initiatives that they're bringing forward, and don't be surprised that, you know, like what we're seeing just now is assertive unionism, aggressive unionism. And at some point, and I think this is going to be coming pretty soon with the case for the union, is they're going to sit back and say, this isn't working. All this is doing is driving support for independence. So what you might, and it might scare independence supporters more than the aggressive unionism, is the touchy-feely unionism, which might actually start to come within the few weeks and months, because there's a number of Conservative people at Westminster just now who are looking at what they're doing. I mean, they put Douglas Ross in charge, one of the most charmless people you'll ever meet in your life. I mean, this guy.
I heard you got in a dust-up with him. There was an article you got in a dust-up with him the other day.
Anytime he speaks, you know, it's just aggressive nastiness. Yeah. And some wise heads in unionism are actually starting to say, we've tried this. It's not working. All it's doing is driving support for independence. And I would actually worry more about the touchy-feely unionism, which might be coming our way soon, because what they're doing just now isn't working for them, and a lot of them realise that. And so watch them. Watch what the unionists are doing, watch what the Tories are doing, because it's probably just as important about what we're doing. And you get little senses and signs of where some of this is going. Now, they might just continue with the aggressive unionism. And, well, it'll just drive support for independence, so they could do all this, but it doesn't work for them, though.
I just want to get into a few more questions with the few minutes we have left about Lord Keane on the brink of resigning following the departure of the head of the government legal department, Jonathan Jones, earlier today. Any reaction to that? You said you barely know him, but...
Well, I don't think this is a great surprise. I think the person that's under most pressure tonight is Robert Buckland, who's the Secretary, who's actually the guarantor of our international relations and the legality of the UK as a state through its obligations when it comes to the international community. And I think he'll have to have a look to see just exactly how he could fulfil his roles and obligations with what's happening. But I don't think we've seen the end of legal officers resigning. I mean, this is an untenable position for them to be thrown in. I would be very surprised if our good friend Lord Keane went. You know, I mean, Lord Keane, of course, most of your viewers will know, is the man who said you'll have had your sole convention and eat it then, and that was his role and his role in the prorogation case. But you know, I mean, there's nobody else really could take that role on. But you know, it's anything's possible. Tomorrow will be a very dramatic day at Westminster when this bill's introduced. We're having a little thinks to see if there's things that we can do. But everybody expects us to do loads of things at Westminster. But this isn't the days of Parnell now. This is a managed democratic institution where the opportunities for disruption are totally limited. I've been in the House 20 years and I sort of know how it works inside out, and we look at things that we could do, but it's really difficult now because we've got guillotines in place and all sorts of ways and means to ensure that, you know, the business of the day is approached seamlessly. So, you know, like I know everybody wants to see us do the dramatic gestures, but they're really hard to try and find things to do.
What are they saying? What are you going to do when the power grab happens, which is in law, you know, ready to go? We see it with the internal market. I mean, I mean, the Scottish government's going to resist, right? I mean, they're going to fight tooth and nail.
Totally, and they will. And, you know, like I think everybody could see the determination to try and resist and take this on. And, you know, I mean, I'm not familiar with exactly the tactics that they're going to deploy about all this, but, you know, I mean, it is unacceptable. The Internal Market Bill is an invidious piece of legislation that has huge impacts upon the function of our democracy in Scotland and what we thought was the devolution settlement. So, you know, I mean, we have to resist it and fight it as much as we can. But again, we want to be independent because there's a Conservative majority of 80 and they can do what they want to our nation. This is the democratic debate is at the heart of what we're about. When it comes to the independence movement, we don't want to be governed like this. So somebody say, what do yes groups do? We use this to build support. We take this to the streets. You know, that's what we did in Perth when they prorogued Parliament and abandoned democracy. We took that to the streets of Perth and we were able to recruit new people to our cause and case. That's what we do.
Yeah. Okay. Do you expect the EU to reach a hand out to Scotland after the 1st of January?
I think the EU is in a very, very different place just now. I mean, like in the past, it was Barroso was doing a favour for his mate David Cameron when the UK was a member in the European Union. I think that they're warming up to the idea and prospect of an independent Scotland. They can't get involved because of the way that the structure of the organisation would be the treaty-based organisation and partnership. But we've got to speak, and we are. We're regular travellers to Brussels to try and put the case. There's a number of key people who are involved in the EU who are particularly well disposed towards Scotland. I'm thinking Colin McAllister, for example, who's just been appointed as chair of the Foreign Affairs Committee of the European Parliament. You know, I mean, there's lots. David's half Scots, half German. He was tipped to be the future Chancellor of Germany after Angela Merkel. Been, the guy's got a Scottish accent. So there are people that, you know, we're engaged with and speaking to just about some of the situation. And
I know, I know that Nicola Sturgeon's had several meetings with Barnier. So you wonder if there's something been cooked up. I don't know.
You know, believe just how well disposed the European Union is towards Scotland.
That is why I would not exclude the possibility that if the covenant was used to demonstrate a democratic majority, that the European Union would accept it. They know what the UK's like. I mean, they just been through 4 years of horrific negotiations with it, and now they're just throwing it out the window. They say, "Yeah, Scotland, come on in, man. You're welcome. We got the tea, got the kettle on, got the fire going. You know, join us in Brussels."
We quite categorize it is like that, but there is certainly a warmer and more enthusiasm towards Scotland than we've seen for a long time. But we've got to do it right. That's the thing, you know. I mean, I think there was an expectation during 2014 that we'd just say to the Europeans that we wanted to do this, they would back us, and of course they didn't. And that really hampered us.
But it's different now. And again, they accepted a communist dictatorship overnight. Why not? You know. Anyway, I mean, it's an interesting moment in history. One last one. What do you think about the European Free Trade Agreement route for getting back into the EU, or should there be a choice made? Or
we have to be totally and utterly committed to EU membership. Mm-hmm. If we're going to get EU support for our independence, we can't say to them, we want your support to become an independent nation. We're not going to be a member, but we'll stick with EFTA. We have to say clearly and definitively to European partners that the objective for an independent Scotland is to be a full member of the European Union, and that's what we have to offer. And I've looked at EFTA, and I mean, EFTA is a reasonable halfway house solution, but it doesn't help us. That's the thing. We've got to do the things that get us there, and full membership of the EU is one of the things that does that.
Yeah, we need to wrap this up, but I just wanted to make, and again, I just think, you know, given Brexit, given all this stuff, that the covenant is the way forward. Of course, that's my view. You see many more hurdles and impediments, but just think about it. Okay. Talk to your colleagues, you know, maybe. Anyway, it was an absolute delight to have you, and I hope you'll be back on soon. It was a real pleasure to speak with you this evening.
You too.
All right.
What's On guide to live stream events and shows is now available. You can find the guide on the web at independencelive.net, on multiple Facebook pages, or go direct with the web link tvl.ink/whatsonguide.